It's Ham Radio Now, episode 150. Hijinks and Straight Keys. A couple of more shows from the Dayton Hamvention. I'm not sure what Hijinks and Straight Keys have to do with each other. Maybe nothing. Except, yeah, they're both going to be a lot of fun. Let's see. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. I'm the host of the show. Sitting over my shoulder is my buddy Arvin, who reminds you that Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. You bring it to yourself by contributing to the program. Stop by hamradionow.tv. Click on his icon if you enjoy the programs, and you can make a contribution to help keep us going. I'd like to thank everybody who has done that. It's been pretty good this year. I did the numbers. I don't have them available to stick on the program right now, but we're a couple hundred bucks ahead of last year, this time last year. So that's a good trend. Not a big enough trend, but it's a good trend. Okay, so episode 150. Let's see, at 100 we did Big Whoop. So maybe this is just a little whoop, although the folks over at Ham Nation, I think they were getting a bigger whoop out of it.
Hello, everybody. It's Ham Nation time, and this is Bob Heil, K9EID. And guess what tonight is? It's our 150th show, and we got a really good show tonight.
Okay, so yeah, they're at 150 as well, and we'll go sailing on past them. At least in theory, we'll go sailing on past them, although it might take another couple of weeks because I've got a, they'll do 151 next Wednesday. I might not have time to get another episode out by next Wednesday. We'll see. I've got a big freelance project that I'm working on that I need to put in some long, hard, concentrated days. And it's probably going to keep me away from putting any more Ham Radio Now together for another couple of days anyway. Let's see what's next. Oh, I want to thank Newsline, Bill Pasternak, WA6ITF. I sent him a little press kit on the Eris stuff. And he used it in the Newsline that is just out this week and is going to be hitting a repeater near you probably sometime this weekend or sometime during the week. And they stuck it at the end of the show.
Long time since we took you vicariously into space with the Eris School to ISS program, but that's about to change. The online video show Ham Radio Now has produced a four-part series titled Eris to the Max that begins with the usual video of a contact between school students and an astronaut aboard the International Space Station, but then goes much deeper. It also features a panel discussion with two of the students who participated in the contact, the teacher who coordinated it, the leader of the ham club that made the contact possible, and the public information officers who got the word out.
All right. So thank you, guys. Oh, and I sent them, as usual, something that was a little too long to use in one program. So Bill is going to split it up into two and play the second half of the press release that I sent to him next week. So by screwing up and sending him something too long, I get twice the publicity on Newsline. So thank you, Bill. Appreciate that. Let's see. Is there anything else? No, I think we can go to our program. We are going to look at a couple of folks that showed up at the Hamvention. These guys from Ham Hijinks. I don't know if you've been by their website yet. I gave you homework to stop by their website and check them out. They do funny stuff. They write funny stories, and they write them better than the average ham attempting to do humor. They do a pretty good job. We're looking at their website. This image is going to change, and I think it's going to rotate through three of the stories that they've got going now. But they've got over 100 of them up there right now. So, I mean, Game of Thrones. Come on, guys. That's clever. Do I have to explain it to you? Game of Thrones, Game of Thrones. That's the kind of stuff they do. Hamvention makes new scooter-only policy. So you get the idea. We talked to two of the guys that do this. And in fact, it was the first thing we recorded on Friday morning. Cliff and I were standing out in front of the W5KUB booth. alongside the W5KUB booth, and we're just looking at what they were doing there. And these guys, Andy and Kevin, came up and they recognized us. They recognized me. I had no idea they knew who we were. And I said, "I'll tell you what, let's arrange for a Skype interview someday." And they said, "Okay, that'll be fine." And then realized, well, standing there with all the camera equipment, let's just go to a somewhat quieter spot and do an interview now. And so we did, and I'm glad we did. They're having a lot of fun. So we'll get to that in just a second. Number two is the Straight Key Century Club, SKCC. Talk to Ron Bauer, AC2C, about that group. And in between the shows, I'll tell you a little bit more about how I got to be talking to Ron. So for now, let's head on back to Dayton Friday morning, early Friday morning, and we'll talk to the guys from Ham Hijinks. And
so we're going to talk to you, not the camera.
Yeah, yeah. Talk to me. You can talk to the camera if you want.
Okay, we'll do that too. Hi.
who the heck are you guys?
Well, I'm Kevin Thornton, K5KVN, and from the Noise Blankers Radio Group and HamHijinks.com.
Yeah, I'm Andy Holmes, K5PO, also of the Noise Blankers, a group of rogue goobers that basically got together for no reason other than no other club would take us. So we formed our own.
Right.
And our hobbies are amateur radio and writing stories about amateur radio that make us laugh or that poke fun at the hobby and that sort of thing.
What part of the country are you guys from?
We're from Arkansas, specifically Northwest Arkansas.
So if anybody out there has not seen Ham Hijinks, I don't know why you haven't. You guys are into serious humor that I don't think ham radio seen maybe ever, at least not since the Old Man series back in QSD about 1,000 years ago.
Yeah, and actually was part of our inspiration. And all of us in the Noise Blankers Radio Group have some sort of communications or public relations background. So we got together and we thought, well, how can we apply kind of our professional life to the hobby that we love? And one day we were chatting through our messenger program on our phones, and we started sending just stupid news headlines about ham radio, and it stuck.
Yeah, I think, you know, for us it was, amateur radio is, I mean, it's a hobby, right? And there's very practical, very real value to the hobby, but it's still a hobby, you know, so a big part of it is still about having fun, right? And I think sometimes we get so serious about the hobby. Oh, you know, it's very, you know, very serious about how we act.
Well, your ham radio is very serious. You whippersnappers, get off the lawn.
Exactly, right? Or get off my frequency or whatever it may be, right? But, yeah, so I think, you know, there's that tendency for so many of us to make it so serious. And we thought, you know, it's also important we poke fun at ourselves, you know, and make sure we have some levity within the hobby. And that's kind of, you know, the undertone or the reason for, I guess, Ham Hijinks. So, yeah.
So you're saying you have some professional background in this, and it does show. What is some of that background?
Well, thanks. A couple of us, myself included, worked in radio and television on the news side. And
in writing and performing or what?
Well, I was a television weather anchor. We have another gentleman who was a news director.
So you're responsible for the weather we have here today.
No, man, this rain is not my fault.
He's retired from that now. So, yeah that's old hobby. So this is totally Dayton's responsibility at this point. So.
And then Andy is actually heads up communications for a large corporation. So we all kind of have some sort of PR communications background. And you know, for us, it was, I think, the thing that we like the most about the reaction that we get from hamhijinks.com is when somebody will post something on the website or on our Facebook page that says, "Hey, is this real? Is this the truth?" That's when we say, "Yeah, we wrote that one right."
Yeah, you know, I think exactly, because you know, it's the things that are very close to reality, the stories that, because we have some oddities in our hobby, you know, as I think we're probably all aware. You know, that
it's easier to list the normal stuff.
Yeah, most definitely. So I think it's some of those oddities. It's fun to poke fun at, you know, to exploit in a humorous way so we can be a little bit less serious about it. But it's when you get very close to them and people are like, okay, was that real or was that satire? And some people obviously, you know, get links to our stories, have no idea that they have a satirical nature. So they're like, you know, they're very serious.
Yeah, everybody who discovers you for the first time is going to go, what?
Yeah, that's typically how they come across some sort of story, and they're like, "Really? They're gonna, you know, they're."
So, do you guys have a favorite? Is there one that you did that you just said, "Oh my god, oh my god"?
Well, I wrote one that I thought was... so, if you recall, I guess it was Super Bowls ago, the power went out in the middle of the Super Bowl in the Superdome in Louisiana. So I wrote a story, plain fun, that some ham had a special event station there at the Super Bowl. Something with some interference, some RFI or something, was the root of the power outage. Of course, you know, totally, totally made up fictitious story. But a couple of folks got that link and was like, oh, I can't believe these hams did that. I can't believe that's such a, you know, a scar on the hobby, the face of the hobby. Totally fictitious. And they had, of course, no idea. It was satirical and a total lie. But, you know,
that was probably my favorite as well. More recently, we did one about President Obama getting his amateur radio license. And that was
he did?
One. He did? Absolutely. Is this real?
Absolutely.
And that's one that continues to this day to be one of our biggest trafficked stories because people thought it was real. And it went outside of the amateur radio realm. And so it kind of exposed the hobby to some other people as well that may not have known about amateur radio because they thought, the president has a ham radio license? Let's check this out, you know?
Right.
So I do very limited twitting. I don't twit much. I don't tweet much, but you are on my Twitter feed, and when I happen to go look at it, that's where I see you guys. Where's the best place to find your stuff?
The best place is hamhijinks.com. Just go right to the website, hamhijinks.com. But if you prefer
that's a pull there, but you put out so much stuff, you kind of need to push it. Where do you get pushed to?
Well, let's see. We're on Twitter at Ham Hijinks, and we're also on Facebook.
He is a weatherman. He's talking to the camera now,
right,
not to
sorry.
Me.
And so Twitter, Ham Hijinks, and Facebook under the same address.
Okay. So how often do you do stuff? Is it like whenever you feel like it?
You know, I guess we don't really have a set cadence. Our editorial calendar is basically whenever somebody has a good idea. And we do have a queue of stories that we'll queue up. And we kind of lean on our professional background to get a sense for what is newsworthy and timely, because those are the stories that we find really hit home. The Super Bowl was headlines.
We wrote that one was written basically, you know, within a couple of hours or, you know, of the Super Bowl event having occurred. So it very much was viral in that nature. And the current event sort of stuff, you know, writing stories about Dayton, during the Hamvention week, you know, we typically write them in advance, but very timely, that tends to resonate.
So,
obviously.
So you already know what happened here.
Right.
At least from your perspective.
I mean, long answer to your question, but it's probably like one a week, one or two a week is probably our publishing cycle. Unless
like
it's
that.
Something like Hamvention and we're pushing out, I think we've got three stories that went out this week about Dayton.
Is this the whole team here?
No. We missed Gary. Unfortunately, he couldn't come. WB0RUR, Nathan, K5KAC. We've got a couple of other guys, but we're the primary writers for hamhijinks.com, but we're the only two that can make it this year.
Are you guys all local from the same area, or is this now a worldwide operation?
No, we're all from actually the Northwest Arkansas area now. We come from a variety of areas, but we're all now local to Northwest Arkansas.
Okay. Do you want to expand your group? Do you take input from the unwashed public at large?
You know, we get a lot of suggestions from stories. We don't really take any of it, frankly. It's funny because people send stories. Sometimes they are legitimately funny. Sometimes they really maybe aren't quite as funny. Sometimes our stuff isn't, frankly, that funny. But generally, we just like to share our own stories.
Comedy is harder than it looks.
It is. But
it's not easy. This is not for amateurs.
We get some funny story suggestions, but one thing we've talked about, and this is not official, but we've talked about possibly doing a story contribution contest. So you might keep an eye on the website for something like that.
God, I think that's a terrible idea.
Don't do it. It'll probably be terrible. We thought about, you know, we'll give away a Bowfunk or something because they're like $1.35 or, you know, so reasonable prize, something like that. But anyway, we'll work on formalizing something. We think it would be cool because there are some funny stories out there that people don't maybe have a great venue to share them. So Ham Hijinks works out pretty well for that. So maybe I think something we thought was pretty cool.
Yeah.
Do you guys have a line you won't cross? Do you have a limit? Is this an uncomfortable question?
Ooh, a line we won't cross. We tend to stay away from some of the extreme health issues that are prevalent in the hobby. And I say that in all seriousness. I mean, it's because we don't want to offend anybody that way. But there's not a lot that we won't talk about.
Sometimes it's timeliness. I wrote a story about a guy in a de-expedition that, you know, de-expeditions always to these gorgeous, gorgeous islands, right? You know, some of them are actually not that great, but, you know, some are, or to a gorgeous island somewhere, some tropical paradise, right? And they, all they do is sit in a tent, and they work us folks stateside and whatnot, right? Seems kind of odd. I guess I always think, hey, I'm going to go to this island. I'm just going to sit on the beach and have some beers. So there was a story about a de-expedition where they start. They got to the island. It was kind of hot. They started drinking a few beers, and they made literally zero QSOs, and they just all kind of sat around and got drunk, which was a funny story. But around a similar time, not inspired by it in any way, there was a gentleman on the expedition that actually passed away.
Yeah.
I wrote the story shortly before that had happened, but then that happened when we're going to publish the story. We decided, it had nothing to do with him drinking or something on the island or whatever. But it was just one of those deals where timeliness. But
just in case,
that's one you could put away for a while.
Yeah, well, we did.
I think we published it later, or maybe it's still in the. I don't know. Maybe it's still out there somewhere. We don't aim to offend anyone. It's obviously not the thing. But if it doesn't offend likely someone, it's probably a crappy story. So,
Right.
I'm thinking of another group that I ran into a few years ago that was aiming at ham radio humor, but they were definitely nasty. Ham Sexy. Have you heard about Ham Sexy?
Oh, yeah. Absolutely, yeah.
They often will link to some of our stories.
They will. So they're still around. I haven't followed them much.
Yeah. And we do try to stay,
Are you guys ham sexy, by the way?
I don't know. You tell me. What do you think? How am I looking? Huh?
One handy talkie in a backpack, nothing on a belt, more backpack stuff. You guys are not ham sexy.
No,
sir.
I don't think so.
I may be a sexy ham, but we're also not affiliated with Ham Sexy, so that's
But they cross lines, and you're not going
to
go there.
We try to keep it, like PG-13 or something like that. It's not like, for the kids or something, but. Most people that read it probably won't be tremendously offended. Maybe everyone will be slightly offended, and that's probably the right balance.
Do you get much of that? Do you ever get somebody say, what the?
From time to time. I think the Super Bowl story elicited some of that sort of feedback. One guy called us a bunch of sickos. for some reason, that was literally, he called us a bunch of sickos. I'm not really sure why, but I'm sure it made him feel better to send that email, so we appreciate it. You out there, you know who you are.
I will say that, while we don't necessarily strive to be intellectually humorous, if that does happen, then that is good. is good. We like to have that intellectual satire mixed in with the flow, and that's part of, I think, one of the ingredients that we look for in a story. I mean, there are times where we'll write a story and we'll send it to the group and we're like, you might tweak this here. You might add this there to try to add, a little bit of more of a satire. But the thing that we look for is that if you were to read the story, does it sound like it could have really happened? Then that's a golden story for us.
Exactly.
So you do have a little bit of editorial review. You swap these things around a little bit before you put them up.
We do. And that's kind of how our radio group, the Noise Blankers, got together, is that we were using a chat, function on our phones. And we were talking just 24/7. It's like a 24/7 club meeting for us. And that's how we stay in touch. We don't actually have like a standing meeting with an agenda where we take minutes. That's way too bureaucratic for us. We're chatting all day long on the phone, and that's how we bounce story ideas off of each other, and that's how Ham Hijinks got started. It was just an idea where we were just shooting stupid headlines back and forth, and we thought, we need to publish this. Let's do it.
Maybe we need a story beneath that stupid headline we made up on the spot, and we wrote a slightly less stupid story to the stupid headline, and that was really the extent of it, yeah.
When did this get started?
We started in January of, this is 2004, in January of 2013. Is when we started hamhijinks.com.
All right, so it's all archived if someone wants to go back and spend a day reading it, because you guys are prolific.
Yeah, we have
what
done.
Now, yeah.
When we crossed the 1 year mark, we made a cake and put a Balfang candle on it to celebrate the 1 year anniversary. And at that time, we had done just under 100 stories in just a year's time. So we've probably done, May? We've probably done another 15 or 20 stories by now. So we probably got 120, 125 in the archive.
Are you thinking about stepping on my territory, branching out into other media, audio, video?
Ain't nobody got time for that.
So,
I don't have time for it.
Oh, yeah, really? Yeah, we don't strive. The level of prolificness we've attained is almost by accident. We don't really set a goal for ourselves or anything. We actually in the club have an award every year, although no one's won it yet because we don't really get together to meet officially to honor or provide an award. We do have an official award of achievement, but you can only get it if you don't achieve anything. So one of us will win that at some point, and that'll probably be the end of Ham Hijinks because we'll just stop writing, all trying to beat each other and win the award of lack of achievement. But So we don't really have any grandiose ideas of branching out into anything. It may happen. We actually talked about doing some YouTube videos of reading our own stories like a news broadcast, which would be something we're relatively suited for. We really are too lazy to do that. So.
Yeah, and I do want to be clear. We have made $0, nor do we intend to. I mean, this is not a money-making opportunity for us. This is part of the hobby. It's something we do for fun. And that's why we do it. We do it right now because we love it. And, if we have an opportunity to do other media at some point, I guess we would if we had time. Yeah. But
I think we have ads on our website. And, of course, we pay for hosting and we pay for the, site plugins and junk. I think we've generated around 37 cents in ad revenue, so we're really raking it in. When you take the couple hundred bucks in hosting and stuff, pretty much going to get wealthy off this. So,
not a chance.
Never.
So. We need some tips from you on how to make some money doing this.
When I've learned how to make some money doing this, I'll let you know.
Good, yeah.
Do you have time for your day jobs? I mean, how often do you have to go rapidly squelch something from your computer screen when the boss walks by?
I, cannot claim that has ever happened to me. How about you?
Hmm? Yeah, I mean, our stories take about 2 minutes to write.
Right.
If you've read them, you'll see that, we're not highbrow, we're not lowbrow, we're like midbrow, and it's about a minute and a half a story, so a restroom break can probably be a sufficient time to write a hijink story. Doesn't need to really interfere with the job.
Yeah.
My experience is that writing is very slow and tedious. Reading can be quick, but writing, no, I don't believe you. It takes a while to do this.
I'm not really exaggerating too much.
No.
Most of us crank out the stories in seriously like 5 to 10 minutes. They're really,
And I think, he's right. It's because I think all of us have a news background. Like Gary, especially, who was the news director in the group, he'll come up with a story idea, and literally 2 minutes later, he's flowed out the entire story. Dateline, headline, everything.
Yeah.
And all of us, I think, are similar in that method as well because we have that news writing background. So I think it helps.
Good. Keep having fun, and I will keep reading your stuff because there's not much like that in ham radio since the old man.
Well, thank you, and I'm glad we ran into you today, and thanks for the opportunity to talk about it because we just want everybody to have fun and not take things so seriously.
By the way, you said this is your first Dayton.
It is. This is the first time.
Dayton virgins! Dayton virgins!
Absolutely.
Yeah. That's us.
Well, go have fun and stay out of the rain.
Okay, thanks.
Awesome, thanks. Appreciate it. Take care.
Bye, audience.
Thank you for that. That's awesome.
You really want to stop by their website frequently and enjoy their weird brand of humor. Okay, so Straight Key Century Club, what's the deal with that? What I was looking for was to talk to someone about this digital stuff that is going on in the low end of the HF bands. And the complaints that CW operators have had about it, that, the digital folks just kind of barrel in and stomp on ongoing conversations and, take up too much space and stuff like that. And my attitude has always kind of been they're just afraid of the future and, they don't have an appreciation for advancing technology. And I know that that is a gross simplification. There are some people that are just, Luddite about it and got their heels dug in, but I know there's people out there that recognize the need for hams to advance and the need for spectrum to be shared and are just concerned that their mode is going to get tromped on. Digital folks have the same concern. So I was looking around for folks that might be able to talk about that end of things. And the first place I went was the Fists booth. That's been a very strong CW forward group. And I thought, well, that would be a good place to go to find somebody who could talk about things from that end of things. Well, there's only one guy in their booth, an older guy who didn't feel like he was up on the conversation. So he wasn't going to be the guy to talk to. But he pointed me over to Ron Bauer, AC2C, on the other side of that hall, at the Straight Key Century Club booth. And so Cliff and I toted the cameras over there. And I talked to Ron a little bit, and he said, well, he's not the guy to talk about this either. because he operates the digital modes and enjoys them, but he's not really deep into the controversy. And maybe, you know, like the media always does, I'm just kind of ginning up a controversy where one doesn't so much exist. I don't know. You tell me. But he did say, well, how about we talk about Straight Key Century Club? And I thought, I have no idea what this is. So let's find out. And who am I talking about and why am I talking to you?
My name is Ron Bauer. My call sign's AC2C, Alpha Charlie 2 Charlie, sometimes called AC Deucey. And I'm with the Straight Key Century Club. We're a club that was founded in 2006 following Straight Key Night. Straight Key Night celebrates going back to the old days, break out the tube radios, the ones with the chirp, break out the straight keys, the bugs, and rag chew and have fun.
That is New Year's Eve?
It's all New Year's Day, Zulu New Year's Day. So here in the United States, it starts New Year's Eve.
And does it get popular?
Oh, it's very popular, and then people turn into...
Is that equivalent to bad sending night?
Sometimes it's QLF, left foot sending. So, yeah, and the people break out their keys. We have some out here on the table. And we started in 2006, and we're now up well over 12,000 members worldwide. Growing fast, and we have monthly events, operating sprints. A lot of people chase numbers and go for award type things. We have people that do rag chews, and a lot large community does QRP.
Morse code was eliminated as a requirement in ham radio, I don't know, what, almost a decade ago?
Almost, yeah, pretty close to that.
I don't operate much, maybe a little bit on field day, but I hear that it is getting more popular.
It is getting more popular. It's one of those things, now that it's not required, it's now fun to get back into. I think the other thing that's happening is that now it's okay to not know code. It's okay to get on the air and say, I would like to learn, where in the past, you probably learned Morse code, passed your test, and never touched it again. And it was not quite kosher, let's say, to go back and say, I don't know code. Now it's okay. So there's a lot of people getting back into it. The club is all about that, bringing people back in and letting them go out and say, I'm looking for a slow speed QRS, QSO, and we'll help them out.
So it's not just one day a year. You do something all year long.
Yeah, the concept, the chat room after the Straight Key Night in 2006 was, this is fun. Why don't we do this every month? So they started with, let's do a Straight Key Night the first day of each month, and it's grown from there.
Are there particular frequencies this latches onto?
Yeah, we hang around, I would say, the 050s, 14050, 7050, 21050, 3850.
So well up out of the extra band.
Definitely outside of the extra band, and some people call it Slow Speed Alley.
Can you generally find a contact there? How do you initiate slow speed? I guess you send CQ slowly.
Yeah, if you send CQ slowly, somebody will come back to you pretty much at the speed you're CQing. A lot of people do have a tendency they can send faster than they can receive, so you have to be careful of that. You don't want to send out too fast and somebody will come back to you and you can't copy them.
Yeah, when I was growing up, I always heard a lot about answer somebody at the speed they're sending, and I almost never hear anybody say that anymore. It's like that kind of discussion is either not needed or we have forgotten to say it.
Yeah, it could be that that's what's happened, but it is one of the standards in our club is to always respond at the speed that the person's calling and call CQ at the speed you want them to come back. But we also have a interactive website where people can go to, and it's like a chat room. You can list a status or post a message. I'm just starting. I'm brand new. Haven't been on code in 20 years. I want to get back. I can do 5 words per minute. Meet up with somebody, set a frequency, and go off and have a QSO.
Do you have a straight key here on the wait a minute. Wait a minute. There's a bug. There's a bug in the system.
We have keys. We have bugs. These are slowed down to be more manageable than a... If you take a straight key, the old Vibraplex right out of the box, it's tuned for about 30 words per minute. And we put extra weights on them, slow them down. This one, if you get your microphone over near that speaker there. So that you can slow these bugs down and what we call them bug tamers. We also have a variety of straight keys.
So it looks like just a rod extending on the end so the weight can go out farther?
Yeah, and it just puts extra weight on it and extends it just like any pendulum. The further you put the fulcrum up, or whatever that's called, the slower it goes.
Do you have a favorite real straight key there on the table?
Myself, this is my personal favorite. It's a Czech Army key. They were made in the early 1950s. They were found recently in Europe in warehouses. They have a little on-off type switch, and if I can pop it open, a very nice internals for adjusting the tension and the gap. They have a very, very nice feel, and I just, for me, it's my favorite key now. But we also have some others here on the table. This is the standard J38. People know the J38. This is an NT9K Pro Pump key. It was designed by one of our members. And this is our new Straight Key Century Club Patriot key. It's being produced for us by L&R Precision. They're over in the arena, and they are for sale to club members only.
So not only is Morse code getting more and more popular, but keys are getting more popular.
Keys are very popular and very pricey these days.
A good thing to get into. There was something here on the table that caught our attention.
Yeah, that probably was this code course. This is the original, I honestly am not sure whether that's Amico or Amico. I think growing up I called it Amico. But
I think we heard both of them all the time.
Right. And this is the original code course. And it is a set of 78 RPM records, starting from lesson one going up, I think it goes all the way to lesson 20. Or beyond. So
that is going to bring a tear to some ham's eyes.
Yes, I'm sure it will.
So this isn't yours. You don't know very much about it.
No,
but,
this is
but
one
it was
of
here.
Our members brought it here to put out on the table and let people take a look at it. He's out in the tailgate spot. It's Ted, K8AQM, brought that.
All right. Well, Morse code is still alive and it's not going anywhere.
No, it's not. We certainly hope not.
Well, maybe that's not the right phrase, not going anywhere. It's not going away.
Not going away. It's not going away. It's growing.
Thanks for talking to me.
Okay. Thank you.
Cool stuff, Ron. Very nice. Thank you for bringing my attention to something that was going to be very worth showing that I might not have caught otherwise. So that's it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. Once again, I'm not sure when the next one is going to be because I've got a whole bunch going on. I got something I'd like to do, something that I've got on a back burner. I'd like to push to the front burner, but I don't have time to do it. We may do it anyway. We'll see. That's a tease without any information in it for you to just keep watching. I do want to mention one other thing. The episode 149, the one just previous to this, talking especially to the guys on Free TV, Bruce and Chris, that episode has taken off. Evidently, a lot of fans of that mode of communication, and they are watching like crazy and spreading the word. That's important. If you enjoy Ham Radio Now, besides visiting Arvin on hamradionow.tv and making a contribution, the most important thing that you can do is to let other people know about the program. I am convinced of a couple things. One is that it will never be a self-sustaining financially full-time thing for me to do. We're never going to get there. And two, one of the reasons why we're not getting as far as we could is because not enough people know we're here. I'm pretty sure now there's just a lot of people that would really like the program if they knew it was here and had a chance to watch it. And getting the word out is just really hard. I spent, when I did that Newsline thing, I probably spent 2 or 3 hours lifting little quotes out, writing the copy and sending it on to Bill. I was watching a program about podcasting, a podcast for podcasters about podcasting. Podcasters Roundtable was the name of it, for those of you that want to know. And their most recent program was building an audience. And one of the things they said was, you're probably going to spend more time doing publicity than you are doing the actual podcast. And I'm not sure I'd do more time, spend more time doing publicity, but I certainly spend as much time or more time doing all the peripheral stuff, making up the websites. Well, yeah, the publicity, because the website is publicity, making announcements on QRZ.com and amateurradio.com, Facebook, Twitter, as much social media as I can figure out how to use, and I haven't figured out all of it. I even say something on Google Plus every once in a while. Most of that stuff, I'm a real amateur at manipulating. I don't understand that stuff as well as I'd like to. Just don't have time to learn it. So so that is true. I spend a lot of time letting people know. You can help. Let as many people know as, you know, gently. Don't spam mailing lists and things. Just, you know, when it seems appropriate, say, here, this is cool stuff. If you like it, watch it. And if you don't like it, well, don't, you know, don't blame me. Blame Gary. He's the guy putting it out. Oh, boy. So once again, Arvin, hamradionow.tv. Stop on by. Thank you, Cliff, W4FT, for helping out with all the camera work and being my senior executive producer for these episodes. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Thanks for watching. 73, over and out.